The Commission on Higher Education lifts a moratorium that prohibited colleges and universities from offering nursing programs. Now, for more on that, let's now talk to TED Chairperson Prospero De Vera. Mr. Chairman, good afternoon. Nice to have you with us again.
Hi, good afternoon, and good afternoon to all your viewers.
Nice to talk to you again, sir. Now, the moratorium is being lifted because there is a greater demand now for nurses as opposed to before. Why there was a ban? Because there was an oversupply of nurses. But of maybe of greater concern is the quality of education that nursing students will get once schools open more nursing programs or more schools open more nursing programs. How is the TED going to ensure that quality nursing programs, quality nursing education is going to be given to students?
Well, the lifting of the moratorium is not just because there's an increased need. It is also because there's already enough data since the moratorium to make an assessment whether the interventions of government work. No? Mm-hmm. Remember, when the moratorium was imposed, it was because there were about 200,000 nurses who could not find jobs. There was an oversupply. The passing rate in the licensure was relatively low at that time. And there were even the practice of students having to pay hospitals so they can train. So since that time, we have monitored the passing rate in the licensure exams. And the passing rate has been higher than what the government imposed. The mechanisms that we put in place in terms of monitoring how the schools perform, looking at their programs, looking at their curriculum, shows that we have significantly improved the delivery of nursing education. And now because of the demand, because of the global as well as domestic demand for health professionals, we thought it was now the time to lift the moratorium. So how do we assure that the moratorium requirements, once lifted, will ensure quality education? Number one, we have tightened the criteria for new programs that will be opened. They have to have a passing rate of more than 30% in the 3 years once their graduates finish. We require a base hospital for the schools that will apply for programs, and we will continuously monitor the opening of programs. No? So we will make sure that the problems encountered before the moratorium will not happen in this lifting of the moratorium.
That's nice to know, sir. Thank you very much for pointing out the improvements that have happened since the moratorium was implemented. And that was 2011, way before your time as TED Chair, right?
Yes, that was done in 2010. But everyone in the Philippines knows the problem of the oversupply mm-hmm. at that time. Mm-hmm. I remember students having to pay so they could have related learning experience right. and train in the hospitals. Government should not allow that to happen. And we were really producing more nurses than what the domestic need and even the international need requires at that time. Now we have a better grasp of the domestic requirements. We have a better grasp of the requirements to practice their profession abroad. And we have been revising and improving the curriculum of our nursing programs. By the way, Rowan.
Go ahead, sir.
When we closed it, out of the 479 schools that were opening programs, we closed more than 100 because we only allowed 330 out of the 479 degree programs to continue operating. Mm-hmm. The ones that had questionable quality assurance was required to close. Mm-hmm. The other thing is we have mapped out the supply and demand side for nursing. No, we look at the supply side first in terms of enrollment. We now see an increase in the enrollment of nurses, a decrease once we impose the moratorium and because of K-12, but there is now a significant increase mm-hmm. in the number of enrollees. We also plotted the location of the universities that are offering nursing programs, and we identified certain regions where there are very few HEIs that have nursing programs.
Right,
so we have to work on it because we have to make sure there is access. Nursing, by the way, is covered by free higher education. Mm-hmm. So we are encouraging state universities and colleges, and CHED recognized local universities and colleges to apply for nursing programs in the areas where they are really needed, but put a return service agreement in their policy, so that we will have nurses who can serve in the community and serve in the country.
Right.
So if we have a list of the regions where there is the need for higher education institutions where nursing programs are most acute. So the regions in need of more nursing HEIs are those in Mimaropa, in Eastern Visayas, Caraga, Barm, Carb, and Soksargen. These are the areas where there's an urgent need. So we color-coded the different regions. I think you have a slide there on mm-hmm. the
You're showing
regions
it right now.
in need of more nursing HEIs. So we encourage the HEIs in those regions to apply if they are interested to open new nursing programs.
How are you going to encourage them to open those nursing programs, sir? That would require budget, right? Is the CHED going to help them out in coming up with a budget for a nursing program for the HEIs in those regions that do not have a nursing program yet?
Well, actually, they can open because it is covered by free higher education. Mm-hmm. So the tuition and miscellaneous fees of the students in public universities in those areas will be reimbursed by government. So the schools that are opening it will be able to get reimbursement. For mm-hmm. the private schools, I don't think there's a problem in attracting students because there are many Filipinos who want to be nurses. Mm-hmm.
The other question that I was supposed to ask you, you did touch on it already, that the problem of even if we produce a lot of nursing students, a lot of them would still opt to work abroad. And you're saying that you're encouraging the schools to implement properly the return to service program. Is that the term you
use? Yes, because, Ron, nursing is covered under free higher education mm-hmm. in public universities. So since the students who will enroll in public universities will not pay tuition and miscellaneous fees, the schools can impose a return service agreement where the students can stay in the country maybe 2 or 3 years after they graduate, so they can serve in the country before they, if they do intend to live for abroad, at mm-hmm. least they return service to the Philippines, they can practice here for several years before being allowed to go abroad. No? The other thing we're doing is we're also working to make sure our nursing students know the requirements if they want to practice their profession abroad. I just came from Canada recently. We sent 2 education missions to talk to the members of parliament and Canadian authorities to facilitate the recognition of the degrees of our nurses who have migrated there. And number two, to tweak the curriculum so that our nursing graduates will be able to apply and practice their profession in Canada. No? We sent 2 educational missions already, and the results are quite okay.
Speaking of tweaking the curriculum, sir, on another issue, President Marcos has ordered for a review of the curriculum here in the country to address job mismatch in the country. Are you all for it? Is it time for that?
Oh, yes. We fully support and commend the position of President Marcos because we've started that already in the nursing profession. There are discussions between the Ministry of Education in Canada and CHED, and agreements already between universities in Canada and the Philippines to see how the curriculum in Canada for nursing and the Philippines can be synchronized mm-hmm. so that our nursing graduates will find it easier if they want to practice their profession in Canada. No? This is an initiative of the Philippine ambassador to Canada, Ambassador Robles, and we laud him for that. Domestically, we have changed or we have reconstituted the technical panels in all our degree programs to review the curriculum and look at mismatches and correct the curriculum immediately. So that has been ongoing already for 2 years now. So we thank the president for focusing attention on the mismatch so that we will get greater support for our initiative to review the curriculum and revise it as needed.
Another thing that the president wants is full face-to-face classes by November. I know you did say that you want the universities to decide on whether they will fully implement that. But for universities who would want to go full face-to-face by November, do you think they're ready? Do you agree with this move?
Yeah, actually, Ron, I think the media sort of did not understand what I said, no? And I was misquoted. Number one, remember, Chet was the most aggressive in pushing face-to-face during COVID. In January of 2021, we already had face-to-face classes in medicine and allied health. In September of 2021 for engineering and other technical courses. And in November last year, we allowed face-to-face in all degree programs. That was November of last year. Many universities wanted to open face-to-face in the second semester in January 2022. But I think the media was not able to cover it because in Metro Manila, we had a surge of COVID and many of the universities postponed their face-to-face because there was a surge in infection. So they moved their face-to-face to the opening of classes in August. But outside Metro Manila, there are a lot of universities already did face-to-face for all their degree programs. In Region 1 alone, Mariano Marcos State University in Ilocos Norte and Don Mariano Marcos State University in La Union already had face-to-face in January. So there have been face-to-face classes already going. Why? Because we were able to increase the vaccination rate. You know, Ron, the vaccination rate in higher ed for education personnel, it is already 90%, and for students, it is already 80%. It is higher than the national threshold. So we have been urging and encouraging universities to do face-to-face classes. Right now, there are graduation ceremonies using full face-to-face. Tomorrow, I will fly to MSU General Santos to give the commencement speech for the graduation of MSU GenSan in face-to-face mode. We already have the UAAP and the NCAA doing face-to-face basketball competition. They finished their championship early part of this year. All of these are things that we have been working hard in doing, especially vaccination. And schools can do face-to-face since November of last year.
Actually, we do remember that, sir, because we actually talked to you about that in our program. So we have been reporting about that.
I think, Ron, the reason is because the Manila media did not see it in Metro Manila in January because there was a surge in Metro Manila. So the schools could not go face-to-face because the surge was really very high. So they all postponed it to the first semester this coming August. So I am sure come August, you will really see a lot of face-to-face classes in Metro Manila and in all parts of the country. I have been talking with the presidents of the state universities. Practically everyone is going to do face-to-face already in the coming school year. So there is no need for the commission to tell them because they have been doing it already since January of this year.
Another issue, sir. If I'm not mistaken, your term is going to end on the 21st of this year. Is that correct?
Yes. Next week.
Right, next week. So what would you say would have been your greatest challenges as CHED chair and the best achievements of the commission under you?
Well, the greatest challenge for most of the period is really implementing RA 10931, the free higher education law. And we're happy that it has been implemented well and there have been no problems. The second one is COVID. Mm-hmm. I think we would have done much more in higher education if COVID did not hit us, because a lot of the universities were affected and the learning process was affected by COVID. But now that COVID is under control, I think things are moving very fast and moving according to plan for the universities.
If given a chance, sir, would you want to continue as Ched Chair?
Well, I have always been supportive of President Bongbong Marcos. I campaigned for him when he ran for senator and for vice president. And so I fully support his administration and I'm ready to help in whatever capacity.
Ched Chair Prospero de Vera, thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you very much.